thank you for the blessing of this time. We thank you for the word that we have with us as we study. We ask that you speak with us and bless our time together. I ask in Jesus' name. Amen. We read Isaiah 29. First part of this Isaiah, we looked at it last Sunday from verse 1 to 14. And today we look at verse 15 to 24, the last verse in Isaiah 29. And I'll be reading from the NIV, the New Translation of NIV. Isaiah 29, from verse 15 to 24. Woe to those who go to great depths to hide their plans from the Lord, who do their work in darkness and think, who sees us? Who would know? You turn things upside down, as if the potter were taught to be like the clay. Shall what is formed say to the one who formed it, you did not make me? Can the pot say to the potter, you know nothing? In a very short time, will not Lebanon be turned into a fertile field, and the fertile field seem like a forest? In that day, the deaf will hear the words of the scroll, and out of gloom and darkness, the eyes of the blind will see. Once more, the humble will rejoice in the Lord, the needy will rejoice in the Holy One of Israel. The rootless will vanish, the mockers will disappear, and all who have an eye for evil will be cut down. Those who with a word make someone out to be guilty, who ensnare the defender in court, and with all testimony deprive the innocent of justice. Therefore, this is what the Lord, who redeemed Abraham, says to the descendants of Jacob. No longer will Jacob be ashamed. No longer will their faces grow pale. When they see among them their children, the works of my hands, they will keep my name holy. They will acknowledge the holiness of the Holy One of Jacob, and will stand in awe of the God of Israel. Those who are wayward in spirit will gain understanding. Those who complain will accept instruction. May the Lord bless the reading of His word. We're looking at a topic today, dealing with the shame within. Last Sunday, we were talking about dealing with the enemy from within. And today, we are continuing with the same chapter, dealing with the shame within. And we come to establish, keeping the connection between these two, and what this point seeks to communicate to us. For those who are just joining us, we've been looking at a theme in effort this year. Behold, I'm doing a new thing. And that is God Himself making that proclamation captured from Isaiah 19. And for us in Seminary Church, we want to see how families will key into God's new plan, fall in line with it, and walk along with Him in this great plan that He's unveiling. And we've got to understand that this is not different from God's plan of redemption from the start. He has been working this plan. He's been moving towards the direction He has said. It is only left for us to key into what God is doing and fall in line into His new plans. To summarize some of the things we have learned in Isaiah to understand the direction of the prophet as it's received from the Lord, one key thing that the book of Isaiah is saying so far is that for every sin there is judgment. And even in God's judgment, there is hope for God's children. There is hope for God's children. When hope is being referred to, as the prophet will capture it in his writing, patience is being called upon from God's people, so that they will not derail from trusting God and focus upon trusting man. And if you look at the account, you will see that many times the nation of Israel will want to focus on the strength of men to protect themselves in order that they will gain victory whenever they have been attacked by their enemies. We've also come to see that in God's dealing with humans, with creation, with people, His justice is like a two-edged sword. On His children, there is discipline that will lead to restoration. While on His enemies, and the enemies of the children of God, is punishment to their destruction. So God's justice does not only focus on the wicked and the enemies of His children to deal with them and to destroy them, but He also disciplines His children. But there is also restoration, because that is the ending when God is bringing discipline to His children. And we as His children should replicate that in our discipline. It is not to destroy our loved ones, it is not to destroy our children, but it is to shape their understanding and bring them back to the place of our enemies. Now the passage we are looking at today falls under the six woes. If you look at Isaiah from chapter 28 to chapter 3, there are six different subsections that is pronouncing miseries. But you see, five of these miseries were directed to God's children in this section. Only one was directed to the Assyrians. What does that tell you? God is more interested in His children, shaping them through hardship most times, so that He brings them back to Himself. And that is what God wants us to do. That our focus is upon Him, not upon others or circumstances surrounding us. Many times we focus on our enemies. Many times we focus on Satan. When things are disturbing us, we begin to talk about how Satan is tormenting us. If you've been reading Food for the Day, the one produced by Apple, you would understand the story of Job, how it is progressive, the challenge that Job faced, and Job's focus. And that is why we will remain blind in the problems we are facing, because we blame one another and we blame Satan. But challenges should bring us back to God. Because when God is purging the society, His focus is not His enemies. Because His enemies are already defeated. His focus is His children, you and I. So that we can understand who we have as our God and come to Him in the place of relationship. And so in this section, I'm not surprised, I'm not shocked, I'm not disappointed that five of the miseries of God's wrath of anger is directed towards His children, only one to the Assyrians. And we shall look at our passage in 2 points, and then we'll conclude. And we'll apply as we journey down the road. Dealing with the shame within. The first point talks about how men turn things upside down. That is what brings the shame, because we have turned every of God's orders, of God's arrangements, upside down. And look at our passage from verse 15. You would see that hiding our sins, hiding our activities is as old as Adam and Eve. You know when they sinned? What did they do? They ran away and hid. And when confronted with reality, what did Adam say? The woman, you gave. So if anyone is at fault here, God, it's you. Because you gave me the woman. That was like a little drama. Drama. And actually, come to think of it, when you connect today's message and the one of last Sunday, you come to find hypocrisy playing out in God's children. And drama or acting is actually, if you look at history, finds its root from the word hypocrisy, where the real is masked with the fake. So the real is hidden. There is a mask that shows something. And if you look at verse 16, you will see, whatever verse 15 of our passage, you see how that is captured. Woe to those who go to great depths, so they commit themselves to every machinations and techniques and activities in order to hide their plans from the Lord. Who their walk in darkness and think, who sees us? Who will know? So this verse captures God's children doing their work in the secret, in dark. Does not necessarily mean waiting for the night to come, but doing things in secret, thinking that if our activities are away from the sight of men, then they are also away from the sight of God. One principal figure they would want to hide their activities from. Remember, Isaiah was right there ministering in the palace. The prophet Isaiah himself, because probably they were thinking, this guy, when he sees what we do, he's the one that tells God. And then God will send some woes through him. And then he sends some disciplinary activities to us. Now, what was the immediate situation? The nation at this particular point was under threat from the Assyrians. And instead of trusting God, they turned the whole thing upside down. They decided to go to Egypt. Now look at verse 2 in chapter 30. Who go down to Egypt without consulting him? Who look for help to Pharaoh's protection, to Egypt's shade for refuge? But Pharaoh's protection would be to your shame. So they were doing their things in secret, and the prophet came and addressed them, and he said, woe unto you! Because you see, you may hide your activities from the eyes of men, but you can never, no one can ever hide their activities away from God. There is this song that this nursery children, children listen to from Salty. You know Salty, the singing book? Okay. Some of you do not know Salty. That would probably be the BBC's. All right. There's this song. Don't play hide and seek from the one who loves you. Don't play hide and seek. Okay. So, people are trying to play hide and seek with God. You can't hide from God. That's the last punchline on that song, because you can't hide from God. They must have thought to themselves, if the prophet does not see, then God does not see as well. Now, we need to understand also how that God is displeased with this activity of his people. They were supposed to run a country under God's rule. They were supposed to run a country under God's will and under God's direction, based on the covenant they entered. You need to understand that. It was supposed to be according to how God has called everything to be. So, they are not hiding away from him because they were not ready to do the will of God. This is what manipulative people do. People come to leadership in different countries, including our very own country, to uphold the constitution, to make sure that there is peace and justice in the nation. But what happens after that oath? They promote their own interest and the interest of their people. That is why Africa is suffering. The whole world is facing this same situation. That is why Nigeria is crumbling. Because some people took oath and they're doing something different from what the documents stipulate. And you think we'll have peace? And you think it will be well with us? It will not. Because that is deception. And people think no one is watching. The same thing happened in our places of work. when our sister was being prayed for, some words were mentioned. When the youth were presenting their song, there's something they're planning to do. When you are confronted with corruption in your place of work, what should you do? Especially when nobody is seeing you. Or let me rephrase that. Especially when no Christian brother or sister is seeing you. What will you do? I will leave us with that question, and hopefully we'll come during the meeting and get challenged. The same thing people do, manipulating things even in the home. Some of us are living in our marriages under oppression from our spouses, from our parents, from our children. But when we come out and put up a face, we're a happy home. We smile. When a smile is mechanical, you will know. You want me to tell you how to tell a smile that is fake? I'm organizing a class for that. Because you have to pay for it. So that you don't learn how to beat the system. But those are some of the hypocrisies that we observe in our homes. Turn and come into the church, in the workplace, and even in our country. Thinking, when nobody sees us, God does not see us well. But you know what? When people pretend that God does not see, it means nobody will hold him accountable. But the prophet is telling them here that God is seeing you, because what you're doing, he will hold you accountable. You know, hypocrisy is a sign of spiritual blindness. When I say men, I mean in the generic sense. When men do these things, thinking that God does not see or knows, they are actually the ones that are blind. You know, they are playing the ostrich. You know, the ostrich is the biggest bird, right? I have seen an ostrich before, I think. An ostrich is almost as big as a horse, but it's a bird. But you know the funny things that ostriches do? When they want to hide, they put their heads inside the sand. And because they cannot see anything, they think nobody sees them as well. That's an ostrich. The whole body is outside. You know, the head is very small. So they bury the head in the sand, and they think we're hitting ourselves. Who is blind in that sense? It's the ostrich. But every other person around is looking at the ostrich. You need to see when my children play hide and seek. The youngest one will be somewhere and he's thinking he's hiding. You know, a 2-year-old, what do you expect? We just come and stand behind this stand and say he's hiding. So when men do things thinking God does not see or knows, they are the ones who are blind. In fact, not only that, I will even take it a notch higher. Psalm 10:11 will tell us that it is only the wicked that will see. God does not see their activities. It's only the weak. So the person is not only blind, the person is evil and wicked. Because in their thinking, they make God to be a fool. They question God's wisdom. They question God's knowledge. Look at verse 16. You turn things upside down, as if the potter were taught to be like the clay. See, they are making themselves equal with God. That's blasphemy. Shall what is formed say to the other, to the one who formed it, you did not make me? Is that possible? Can the potter say to the potter, you know nothing? So when men do this, thinking God does not see them, they are turning God to be a fool. God lacks understanding. God sees nothing. God cannot understand it. He does not see their activities. So invariably they are putting themselves in God's throne. And you know what that means? Idolatry. They prefer to trust themselves than to trust in God. That is the peak of man's pride, arrogance, and unbelief. Man can be very arrogant. when you focus on your manipulations and rely on your wisdom and knowledge, you've made yourself to be an idol. That's the best thing. And you know, an idol is less than a human being. So the best you can be is less than a human being. Why not just accept God and be a human? That's promotion. Dealing with the shame within. The second point talks about how God turned things right side up. When we talk about God turning things right side up, what God is dealing with here is the problem of sin. Because everything finds its root in sin. What we see the prophet capture here is a total transformation where God will turn everything right side up, and that is restoration. God will restore things back to how he intended them to be, back to his original plan. And again, in the prophet's way, he is talking about something God will do in the future while relating to the events that were happening on ground at that material time. And so the prophet will say here in verse 19 that only the meek and humble, those who will obey God, those who have a teachable heart, those who are willing to do his will without conforming to the things of the world, those who will not be hypocrites. You see, hypocrites are conformists. They want to blend into the general trend. They are not fit to enjoy the peace and the joy of God because they are hypocrites. But God is looking for the humble, those who have a teachable heart, who will not conform to this world, who will not compromise to share in his joy. These are the only ones that will share in the joy of our Lord. We're talking about people who have received Christ in our own time, people who have enjoyed transformation. And this is how God has done it. As we will see, that first, God will remove the shame of his children by dealing with their iniquities. And we'll talk about the iniquities of God's children here. We're talking about idol worship. Not only that they have become idols, but they were worshipping idols. When shame is being mentioned in this sense, it is talking about the shameful things that the children of Israel did by worshipping idols. But you see, the prophet did not stop there. He didn't stop there. Verse 22. Therefore, this is what the Lord, who did Abraham, says to the descendants of Jacob, no longer will Jacob be ashamed. Now, when God is bringing Abraham into this discourse, God is talking about the history of redemption. He's calling it to action. How that he intends to take away idols from his children. Because you see, Abraham himself was delivered from idol worship to faith in Yahweh. In case you didn't know, Abraham was an idol worshiper when God called him from the Ur of the Chaldees and entered into a relationship with him. And when Abraham believed, it was credited to him as righteousness. So this is the shame that God is going to deal with in the life of his children. He would deliver them from the worship of idols. And the same way they would remember when he would call upon Jacob, Israel, the descendants of Israel will remember when they were in Egypt under slavery, under their lords, the Egyptians. It was a similar picture of idol worship because they were under the power and the influence of people who served idols. And so God is saying that even at this material time, as the prophet was communicating to the children of Israel, I am still going to deliver you from this shame that you've gotten yourself into, from this shame of sin, because I am a covenant-keeping God. And so in spite of their faithlessness, God is doing a new thing in their lives. Amen? Amen. Friends, as much as we are faithless. God's program is moving, and he will accomplish it. Whether we believe it or not, he will accomplish his program. And that is what he's promising them. And by this declaration, the exile is captured in view at this moment. So the prophet, at this moment, he was transiting to what, 150 years ahead. You will go to exile, and remember, going to exile was God's program of taking them out of the land so that he would cleanse it, take out the idols, and even the idols that they would take in their hands in their flight. The load of those idols will overwhelm them and they will drop them so that they will have free hands in order to run away. God is going to take away those idols away from them. By hook or by crook, using human language. So running away, he takes the idol away from them. The ones they will live in the land, he cleanses them out. And after that, restoration. I see God looking for those who will catch a glimpse of his direction, of his movement. How many of us will say like Isaiah, I have seen the Lord in his holy of holies? How many of us can say like Isaiah, here am I, send me? How many? We are so engrossed in ourselves. We are so carried away by what we desire. We are so lost by the things that we want. And we don't even know God's direction anymore. Friends, by our own, look to your right, to your left, we are hopeless. In case you do not know that yet, look around you. Not only that we are hopeless, the situation itself is hopeless. It's hopeless. But God wants to take away your shame and your iniquity. What is that thing that is holding you back? God wants to take it away. What is that sin that you've embraced to your chest in secret that no one sees, no one knows? God wants to take it away. He wants to deal with that shame that you've been carrying. God wants to do a new thing in your life. Are you ready to accept it? And we see again how that God will remove their shame that is expressed in fear by dealing with their enemies. If you look at the C part of verse 22, it says, no longer will Jacob be ashamed, no longer will their faces grow pale. Now, the idea of their faces growing pale pictures fear from the violence they have suffered. If not that God's promise is covenant, if not that he kept it himself, the nation Israel will not be in existence today. But they exist because of his covenant. And I say it just as a psalmist. If the Lord had not been on our side in this nation, we will not wake up one day. Our enemies would have overrun us. But as long as Jesus is alive, as long as the church is here, I keep saying this, nothing is going to happen to us. We are doing this world a favor. The day we leave this world is finished. And so the violence and the humiliation that they have suffered from the defeat that is even making them to seek help from men, God in his just character will deal with the unjust as captured in verse 21. Those who with a word make someone out to be guilty, who ensnare the defender in court, and with false testimony deprive the innocent of justice, God will visit them. Because you see, as someone said earlier, if there were no justice, then the whole situation would be a crazy one. It is in God's justice that hell exists. Because the evil the vile, the wicked, the sinners must be punished. Otherwise, God is not just. Faith and confidence will be restored. And this is the promise that God is giving his children to become. And friends, I say the same to us. God will one day deal with our mediators. He will. Again, we see how that God will remove their shame by turning their children to worshipers. This is what we have in verse 22. You read it down. From verse 22 down to 23. When they see among them their children the work of my hands, they will keep my name holy. They will acknowledge the holiness of the Holy One of Jacob and will stand in awe of the God of Israel. Amen. Amen. This is how God will deal with the shame within his own children. He will turn their children to worshipers. It will be the work of God's hands and not the work of any human ability. It will be by his own power. He will first push them off sin, as we talked about the exile. Then he will set them on the right path. And that is talking about restoration. Amen. See, here also embedded in this statement of the prophet, God is assuring the nation of Israel, his children, that there will be a generation that will come after you. Do not be overwhelmed by the situation that is happening. I have a generation that will come after you, and I will make them a generation of worshippers. Amen. So, as long as Christ has not returned, don't be overwhelmed by the situation you see today. We will have a godly generation after us that will carry on the battle and take on this evil age with the light of the gospel of Jesus Christ. It is our responsibility to ensure that that generation comes to stay. That a godly nation will never cease. There will be continuity of godliness throughout all generations. When God will turn his children into his worshippers, his power will show for itself throughout all generations. And lastly, God's restoring power will bring about the salvation of the nations as well. If you compare verse 10 and 12 of the same chapter to verse 17 to 19, this is what you find. Verse 10 says, the Lord has brought over you a deep sleep. He has sealed your eyes, the prophets. He has covered your heads, the seers. For you, this whole vision is nothing but words sealed in a scroll. And if you give the scroll to someone who can read and say, read this please, they will answer, I can, it is sealed. Or if you give the scroll to someone who cannot read and say, read this please, they will answer, I don't know how to read. Now go to verse 17. In a very short time, will not Lebanon be turned into a fertile field? And the fertile field seems like a forest? In that day, the deaf will hear the words of the scroll. And out of gloom and darkness, the eyes of the blind will see. Amen. Restoration. Restoration. So the same people who lack understanding, even talking about the Gentile nations that were far from God, is going to bring them very near, and they will have understanding. They will see. They will read. They will understand. And you see, this is the beauty of the whole thing, that the restoration of the children of Israel will bring about the restoration of the nations as well. So the prophet is going ahead, talking about the benefit of this relationship that exists between the children of Israel and Yahweh. How that the benefit will capture the promise that was given to Abraham from Genesis 12. Through you, all the nations will be blessed. The people's sensitivity will be restored so that they can come back to life. So that they can understand, so that they can obey the things and the will of God. God is in the business of restoring his creation. All that sin destroyed will be fixed by God. We live in shame and in humiliation, but God is going to set everything right. Amen. God will set fallen relationships. He will fix them in our homes. Fallen relationships. He will fix them in our society. Fallen relationships in our nations. He will fix them. In Christ, He will fix them. They look impossible, right? Yes. But in Christ, He will fix them. He will fix them. And when all of this order is set, this transformation that God will bring will make all of us to realize the holy God that we serve. Transformation will bring about holy living and transformed attitude that will have teachable hearts where God's people acknowledge Yahweh as the holy God. Amen. Amen. So when you look at yourself and you see that you don't fit into this, know that you don't have the Spirit of God inside of you, because God is going to enable all of this to happen through Christ. If you don't have Christ, there is no pretense. It cannot happen with you. No matter how hard you try, it can't happen. It can't happen. I want to conclude with these few words. That the clay makes it look like it made itself, or is even above the water. That is how some humans feel today. Because they have some means in their hands. Whether it's resources, whether it's power, they feel they are more than who? God. They feel that even God should answer to them now. Yes. They feel that they can make things happen by the pronouncement of their mouths. Are we not witnessing this in Nigeria? Forget it. Is it not humans we are dealing with? Be patient. Remember the song that the boy has lived? Be still. Because the master is in the boat. Be still. Man can show pride. But at the peak of pride is a display of foolishness. A display of arrogance. And is directed towards God. Mutumba is a rule. Mutumba, Pashi is a rule. Man does not fear God. When we talk about the blind and the deaf and the crippled, friends, I want to announce to you today that the worst kind of inability is the spiritual one. There are people who have physical disability, but spiritually, they are giants. They are giants. And that is what counts in God's kingdom. Sensitivity to hear God comes from the meek and humble. Those who have been transformed. You know, the Bible says we were once blind, but now we can see. Be careful to engage in sin because God's anger will come upon you. Sin destroys God's work, and that is why it displeases Him. And I know that when you look at our world today, you know that the world looks so broken, as if it is irreparable, because of so much sin. But don't undermine and limit the power of God. He created this world. You know, we are celebrating 50 years that man stepped on the moon. I don't know if you've been following that history. And I was watching the video when Armstrong put his feet, the very first one on the moon. You remember what he said? I can't quote him verbatim, but they captured his voice there. He said, one little step from Armstrong to the moon. One giant state of humanity. By his presence stepping on the moon, humanity has captured for that. But you know what? I saw a picture that is said to have been snapped from, I think from Jupiter or so. They snapped the planet Earth from Jupiter. Do you know what the picture showed? A small speck. Like a dust, just a small speck. The size of Earth that was captured on camera from Jupiter. I think it was from Jupiter or some other planet. And the writer said, imagine yourself in that place. How proud can you be? How big a pride can you have? God created this earth and he's able to renew it. God created you and he's able to renew you. No matter how broken you may think you are, he's able to renew you. And the last question I want to ask is this. What is it you are hiding from God? God knows us, he's our maker. And I want us to remember that we are here to accomplish God's purpose, not our own. So that thing you're doing, if it's not accomplishing God's purpose, you better leave it while there is still there. God sets us apart so that in and through us, all people will worship him. So when people encounter you, when they see you, when they live with you, does it drive them to worship God? Or does it make them to start thinking, is this how this Christian is? When we focus on our ways and not God's ways, we are saying to God, we know what is best for us more than he does. But you know what? Our character shows our God. I'm serious. Your character, the way you live your life, shows who your God is. And I see some of us, even here, me and you, our God is not the same. I'm very sad to say this, but I see some, living among us, me and you, our God is not the same. Because your character does not show that you serve the God that I serve. I'm not negating the fact that we're imperfect. I'm talking about the consistency of our characters. When it is not the same with what God has stipulated, then me and you, we are not serving the same. Because God says, be holy, for I, the Lord your God, am holy. So those who belong to Yahweh will live like him. There's no doubt about that. Obedience is what God wants. No matter how hard it is, he wants us to obey. And I'm speaking to myself. Obedience is very hard. But that is what God wants from us. That we surrender to his will. That through Christ, he enables his children to fulfill his holy requirements. It is only through Christ that will happen. So the call today to all of us is this. That in the midst of all of the happenings and the challenges, friends, be still. Be still. Trust only in God.